So welcome back, everybody. This afternoon, I thought, as I told you this morning, that we'll take three main topics. One is just catching up a little bit on how to export your images for publication. So I want to give you some tips on when everything is ready and how to make sure that what comes out from the journal is what you want. The second one, so that's here the first case study I'll show you. The second thing is to just show you some of these advanced things. Maybe I'll actually flip these, so I'll go through creating and preparing the poster before we go into these more advanced tools. And we'll see how long we get to before coffee. We may actually be done earlier than the coffee here. And then we'll get into the topics of the questions. So we can have, at the last session, just going through specific questions and if you want to show some issues you have had. And I hope I can cover everything that was brought up this morning and also the things that you wrote in from the earlier course evaluation. So when I think about exporting for the journals, there are often things you need to think about: what's the quality of the journal also. So when we publish in high impact journals, they are very highly edited. So if you think about things that are published, maybe not so much in science, but maybe science translational medicine is a good example of very highly edited pictures. So they like to make everything into their own look and feel, and they even sometimes redraw graphics. And when you have these type of journals, you want to work with them with all the quality and adjustability of your images as you can. But when you trickle down and go to still good journals, but in sort of mid-impact and lower, they have much less time to spend on each of your drawings. And often they just put all these figures in as they were initially. So when thinking about publishing in those journals, you want to make sure that you make it as easy for them to work with this as possible, and the risks of artifacts and other things being minimized. And that's where I'm actually going to start, is to try to make fail-safe images that will always look good for the journals that you work with. And this is unfortunately a little bit more cumbersome than it should have been, because what you're working with is a two-step process. When you submit to the journal, they make this automated system to bring everything into one PDF that they send out to the reviewers. And you want to make sure that it looks good in that automated process. And those are normally made by these web-based system that just takes each image, puts them centrally on A4 or letter, and then just put their own header and footer and send them out. So there, you want to make sure that they are actually not scaled. So what I often see when I review papers is that somebody has made a very nice looking small image, 3x3 centimeters, and then this automated system just expands it to fill the whole page. So it looks overly large and not great. So what you can do in that way, it's more of a just a tip than a technical challenge, is to make sure that once you have done your image, and I can take that example from last time, is so when you have this, let's say the montage one and the finished version here. So this one was, as before, the document setting in width here. So this was created like this. And before I export that, it's a good alternative to make sure that your white area is actually the full A4 width. And that's a very simple thing to do. Just go into your document setup in InDesign and make that your page size should be A4 if you're submitting to a European journal, otherwise letter to the American. And then you decide where this should be on the page instead of their online system. And so that's, when you do it like that, then you're sure that it will look the same size as you prepared it. So that's the first tip when submission. The other tip is that they may not accept PDF files. If they accept PDF files, you normally can export them just as that. But normally they have restrictions on that they should be EPS files or TIFF files. And there you want to make sure that you export them as EPS files. With EPS files, you have two challenges. As we discussed last time, the EPS files do not contain fonts. So they require the person that receives it to have the same fonts that you do. And in this automated web-based systems, they may have a very limited font structure there. So then you have this possibility, both in Illustrator and in InDesign, to go in and sort of cement the size, the look of your lettering. And you want to make sure that you don't do this in your original document, but save a copy for submission. So in that process, the package command is excellent, so that you can take the package and just save your original image first, and now you can make this call maybe for submission. So then you have saved this in a special folder. It's a new document, so when you modify in this, it doesn't destroy your original. And then you can select everything in this one. So you select all, and then in your type, you can create outlines. And then it finds all the fonts in here and just creates outlines of those lettering. So you see nothing has changed in the look and feel of this image or this montage, but it's totally independent on which fonts your recipient has access to. So doing that before you submit your images, you're sure that nothing will change. Because just a slight modification, say that they didn't have Myriad Pro but had regular Myriad, they may have different spacing of lettering and everything may be just slightly shifted. But by creating outlines, you know that this is sort of, it looks exactly as what you want it to look. And then why I say that you should do this on a copy is that you see now, of course, that you cannot modify this text. So if you spot something that's an, right. So now you see what was not supposed to happen is because these were grouped. So it could not outline text in groups. So before you create your outlines, you want to make sure that all is ungrouped. And there you have this shift command G, shift or shift control G, and to ungroup everything. And then you can go into this create outlines. So now you see that all text is this outline. So that's what I wanted to end up with, except for one group here. So you always step back until you're happy with that every text is, it was actually outlined as well. So then every object is now just paths as they were in Illustrator. The second issue when exporting to EPS is that the EPS export function in InDesign is not optimal for the work that we do. And the reason I say this is that EPS is a more limited file format than PDF. You will see that EPS does not support any type of file compression. So it's the EPS files you will generate will be very big. And in some cases, it will work well. But in other cases, if you work with your full resolution image within InDesign and then export it as an EPS, you will see that this file will be too big and with a lot of unnecessary information. And for that, there is actually a way around this. And what you can do is to do a two-step system. This may sound a bit counterintuitive, but it works really well. And it is to start from InDesign, where you have your final montage, and you export it as a PDF. So you go for a print PDF, and then we just save that to the desktop, and then we call this And when you export in the EPS command in InDesign, hopefully this will change in the future, but in the PDF export dialog, you have all of these possibilities to downsample images and to crop image data to frames. That is not available when you export directly to EPS. So what you want to do is just to make sure that you have one that does not compress any images at all. So you say compression none to all black and white and color images, and but retain the downsampling to 300 dots per inch. And here you can now have the highest version of PDF. That doesn't matter, it still works well. Because now what you want to do is just to make one PDF that you can then open in Illustrator. So you do this first, and what you have done is a full quality PDF that has the right page size. It has everything the right way it should look, and it now has downsampled all the images to 300 dots per inch. And then you open this PDF in Illustrator. And now it says that it does not have a font, but it doesn't matter. So here you can now say that I still want to maintain this in RGB. So now you have the full page looking identical as it did in InDesign, but you can now save this as a pure EPS. And then you go here and save this into the EPS format. So this will mean that you can now have all your files in the same type of EPS. And with EPS, you have, just as with normal Illustrator files, different versions. And this is the other tip, that you want to maintain this as the lowest possible version you can get around with what is the content of your file. So if you have a lot of transparencies and other things, you may need to go up to the version CS2 or CS3 to retain all that look. But if you have a file like this one, where you have no transparencies, nothing else, you can go to Illustrator 9. And the Illustrator 9, why there's this difference between EPS Illustrator 9 and 10 is that it went from what's called PostScript level 2 to PostScript level 3. And this is sort of the new things where everything is fancy in it. And the higher, if you go to PostScript 3, some of the early submission systems on the online cannot handle them. So first start with the Illustrator 9 EPS. See, does this look good after I've exported it? And if it does, maintain that. Otherwise, step up to CS2 or CS3 EPS versions. So you exported us that one, and then we now have a final EPS version. And this EPS file, if we compare the size of that one, you see it's 7 megabytes. The intermediate PDF is 2.7. So the you see that it balloons from this PDF file up to a larger file again, and that's because the EPS file is such an uncompressed file. But that's a natural thing, that it will expand like that. On the Windows side, what you can do is to open this file again then in Illustrator, and you don't want to update anything to the new version of Illustrator. You just open it as it is, and you confirm that everything looks good, that nothing of your quality has been lost. On the Mac side, you have one more way to look at this, and this is actually to open it with the preview application. So then you're really putting this into the test, because you're moving it to another application, and it then sees all your looks. And there you see that this now has changed this to a CMYK image, because EPS only supports internally CMYK. So now you see how it will actually look in the print, and you have to then adjust your images to look good on your CMYK. But you see that it has otherwise retained everything else in your file. All the quality of the text is still there, but your images is downsampled to be 300 dots per inch. So that's the recommendation when going from InDesign, is to take this step in with a PDF in between, and then save it as your EPS. With this image, it isn't as high resolution, so you will not see a dramatic effect compared to if you export it directly from InDesign to EPS. But in many other cases, it can be tenfold as large, the file. And then if we call this But when you see the EPS export in InDesign, you have much less of options. You cannot set what resolution your images should be. So you only have this option of level 2 or level 3 PostScript. And so the end file will be larger. In this, I wonder how much larger, but yeah, you see it's now 21 megabytes compared to the same one that's 7-8 megabytes from Illustrator. So you see it has cut down a bit.
It looked like you had the option of choosing color mode.
Yes. So that's the difference when you step up from version 2 to version 3 of PostScript, that you can support. And this is where things are a bit muddy, because the original file format doesn't support RGB, but you can export it as RGB in InDesign. You can also do that in Illustrator. And it may work, and they may get it right, but you need to test that. It's not always sure that you can get them out as RGB and that the system will read it. So test both things. And so you can see the same thing in Illustrator. If we open that PDF again, if we have it as RGB, and then you save it as an EPS, and then if we call this here, yes, so you can then have here in include the CMYK. I wonder if you can actually change that. Maybe you can't force it actually in Illustrator to include RGB. But I know the later versions of the EPS file can include RGB data as well. Let's just see if it maintains that in this. Yeah, so when I exported this as the CS5 EPS, you can compare this one to the EPS from Illustrator 9. It should be here. You see quite a big difference between this one is your RGB version, and it's maintained as the green here versus the CMYK in that one. So these can be dramatically different if you try to export. So that can actually be a good point to try the higher versions of EPS if you have a lot of fluorescence in to maintain your RGB.
Does it matter for the submission?
So the thing is that it's good to maintain RGB as far as you can, especially when you send it out to your reviewers, because they will see it on screen. So if you can have it in RGB, it's much better than trying to push this version of that image. So it's a big gain to maintain it in RGB. So that's really where I wanted just to show these examples on how to get things out, that you can always go via PDF into Illustrator to make everything in the same format and have better control of it. But if you don't have a lot of excessive data, then you can export it directly from InDesign. But make sure that you do these outlines of your type, because then you're always safe that it will not look rubbish in the end. Okay, so next question is, there has come up a couple of questions around InDesign, and we haven't worked so much in InDesign before. And one of the main questions is, can I use this to produce posters? And this is really one place where InDesign works really well, is to work on data for posters. And I thought I can show you just how I think about when I design a poster from scratch in InDesign. And I always work with my data, my text files in one side, and then the images I want to have on the other side. And I may work with the text actually in Word from the start. And when you go into your, we'll just open it up here, and we go to the poster. When you work with your text in Word, you can actually utilize a number of features in Word that will rapidly increase your speed of producing the poster. And the first thing is something that's normally a nuisance when you work with Word is column breaks. And column breaks are preserved when you move text from Word into InDesign. So when you have a column break, like I just took, this was just text I had from a poster and moved it into Word, is that this will move from one text box to the next. So if you have a column break, it will move the text below that to the next text box. If you have a page break, it will work the way that it will move to the next page. So if you have five text boxes in one page and a page break, it will then, even if your text ends in text box one, it will move to the next physical page in your InDesign as well. So therefore, work with column breaks if you want to maintain it in a poster with different columns, and work with text breaks if you really want it to be a text break, a page break, to be to the next page in your InDesign document. The other thing is that it also preserves your styles. So in Word, you have this option to either use styles called the body or level 1 to 9 here. But you can also go into the styles dialog. And in this styles dialog, you can create your own styles. So I have named a couple: introduction, method, normal, and results. And I can then have one also that could be conclusions. So what I then do is that I just label the part that wants to be conclusion and add a new style. And you don't need at all to format it in the way you want. You just need to have it as a unique own style. And then you click that one, and now this old text is marked as a conclusions paragraph. So I see that, just double check, I have my methods is down here, and my results section is marked as results, and that one is also results. And then you have, maybe this one could be actually the same as conclusions. And then you have your introduction at the top. So this is how far you want to go in Word. You don't want to spend more time there generating any more layout or anything else. But just make sure that it sort of has the basic structure of what you want to bring in into InDesign. Because it saves you a lot of time making sure that all texts look the way you want it. Then in InDesign, you can now create a new document. And the document that you create there is the full size of your poster. It doesn't matter if you want to print it on your own A3s and glue it together, or if you send it to a print shop. You want to here make it the full size of your poster. So maybe we can make this as a landscape. It could be 150 centimeters times 1 meter in size, and maybe we can have 50 millimeter margins on this one. And then you don't want this to be facing pages. You just want one single page. So no facing pages on that, and then you say okay. So now we just have the outline of the full page. And if you want to work with this in a structure of columns, you can then here in the layout go and create your margins and columns. And in this case, I may actually want to have 4 columns because it's such a wide poster, and have this 70 millimeter gap between those. Or maybe that's too much. Just make this 50. So just to have a crude structure, you will then, of course, be able to move outside this structure, but just something to aid you from the start. And then you can now place your text. So you go into the place command, and you then go to the poster text. And we can show the import options. So in import options, it actually goes in here and says that it imports your styles. And you want this to redefine the InDesign styles from the start if they are different. And then once it is in there, then you can choose to use the InDesign style definition. So because the advantage with this is that you can then go back to your Word document, modify the text, and import it again, and it will look exactly as the one you replace. So you can go back and forth. For posters, it may not be such a big deal, but for Word documents of longer text that you work in InDesign, it's a great possibility for you to do that, because you can then use EndNote to update your references in the text file. If you miss one, you just put that one in and it will format, and then you can place it back into InDesign. And by having it like this way, that you use the styles, all text will retain the new format that you then use for layout in InDesign. And now you have the text like this, and you see it starts to give you a small preview on the first sentence of that text. So then you can start by placing it in like this. And now you see I only get a very short introduction here. And this is only my introduction. And what you see then is that you have a plus here, and that means that you have more text in it. And that's your next session. So that was my second part of my introduction I had that I wanted to have in a second one of these. And then I can just continue to place these ones out and make them small boxes roughly where I want them until I have all these sections that I had in that document. And now I've sort of created a first very crude layout of my poster. So I know roughly where I want these different ones, because I know how many images I want to put in as well. But you don't want to make these too exact where you want them. Just place them out like this. And then when you have the final one for me will be my methods. And you will see that clearly now we have the methods down here. The good thing with having this annotated from the start is that you see now that I have my paragraph styles. So if you go to the styles and paragraph styles, you see you have all of these introduction, results, methods. Let me go in so you see them here. All of them that I had in Word from the start. And then I can now go to my introduction style, double click on it, and I can specify exactly how this should look. And this one I may want to have, say, the myriad, semi-bold, say 50 points. And you see that it updates only the part that was labeled as introduction. And then I can go in and say that this one should be force justified to fit to my columns. And I may want to have quite some space between my paragraphs there. And now you see that that one flows to the next ones. And I see, oh, this one must be much larger. So I can adjust that one. But you see, once it goes at the end of the introduction, it will not flow more text into that one. So then I've generated a rough style of my introduction. And I can do the same thing for my results section. Maybe I want to maintain the myriad, but to have this 45. And you see that that one updates. And I can go into my methods and say that that one should be maybe then Garamond Pro and 18. So now I have created all of these sort of rough outlines. And I know that however I import this text again, all of these sections will look the same. And we are missing somewhere. This one should be larger. Yeah. So you see how this sort of reflows until I get everything into the boxes that I wanted again. And apparently one of the boxes is too small, because I want to end up with my methods in this side again. So I may have forgotten to put in one here. Maybe it's this guy. Yes, that's the one, sorry. So, and then I have my methods. So with doing this, you now have a rough layout of your text where you can go in and update this in the dynamic way. And by doing this with the styles, you can then go in and say that, well, my results section, I don't like the way it looks. It should then have a little bit of a smaller character size. And you see that the two that I labeled as results are dynamically shifting this. So then you can work with the whole layout of all of it, and you distribute your text to fit to what you want there. So that's one trick of getting started with your poster. And then once you have all your text there, my suggestion is that you just create a new layer to put in your images in, so that you can then lock your text layer to that place where you wanted it, and now start working with your images. And when placing images for the poster, there are a couple of things that I wanted to show you. The first is that you can actually place many images at the same time. So if I don't show my import options, I can now mark all of the images that I want into the poster, and I say open. And then it just says here that it has a, let's see if I can show you that, it has the number 9 on it, meaning that you have 9 remaining images to place. And then you can start placing them up from the left corner and just place them out on top of everything like this. So you see which images you have to work with. And once you have placed all of them, then it goes back to your regular arrow. So now comes one question that has come up from many people is, well, I have worked with these very nice vector graphics, made them in Illustrator just the way I should. Why do they look so awful when I place them in InDesign? And this is actually by design in the software, that it puts a proxy for every image. So the image it shows here is just a very low resolution placeholder for your real data. And that's meant to speed up everything that when you work with it. But it's always possible. Your data is all there. And what you can do is to mark the image of interest, and you can right-click on it. There you have something called display performance. And in the display performance, you can then say that I use the global setting, which is then adjusting everything in the document, or for this specific image, I want to view the high quality display. So you see, when I changed it to high quality, now it shows you the full resolution of that image data. So that can be done either on a single image like this, or you can say that it should use your view settings. And when you use the view settings, it's the global for the whole document. So then you have this in the view display performance, and there you can say that all should be shown as high quality display. And then you see it's not only the one I selected, but when I go to all the other images as well, they also look as their full quality. Yeah, exactly. So the more high resolution images you have in and you show them at full resolution, the slower the software will be and the more memory it will use. So it's a good thing to cycle between these. If you don't need to see that data, you just know it's there, then you go back to the typical display. Or you can even go to fast display and then you see just these boxes. So then it's not even trying to display those images. And then it's the fastest possible version of this. But that's, of course, not what you want to work with when you want to see how your layout looks. But the typical display is normally enough for you to work on the layout. Another thing that I probably should take again in a bit more detail is the differences between your text frame and the content of the frame. So in this case, when I've put them in, the masking frame of this image and the image size is the same thing. So you see this file here, there is now no information outside this box. But if I take just one corner of this one, and I move it in, you see that it starts to crop the image. So now my image box is smaller than the image data. And this is the regular way Illustrator works, that if you don't tell it anything else, it just works on the text box. It doesn't scale the data inside. But there are two other ways to do that. If you want to scale the whole thing, you can do it in two ways. If you want to do it the visual way, you have a scaling tool. And it's this free transform tool that's down here. And when you select this tool, you can then go back to your image here. And now when I take one of the corners, I now scale the whole content as well. So with the transform tool, then everything scales together. So then you can just drag it in and out like this. And if I then go back and to the normal arrow, then it will again crop your data. So there you can move between scaling all and only scaling the text, frame of this data. The other thing you can do is, for example, here, I see that this, if I unlock the text, I see that the text column width here is 312.5 millimeters. So I want to make my image the same width. And how do I do that? Well, then I lock that one and I select my image. And then I can go up here again, but I don't use the width and height boxes here. I use these scaling boxes. And then you say, well, do I have to calculate how many percent I need to increase it to go from this one to 315 millimeters? Well, you don't. You can actually, in this, even though it says 100%, you can put in any measurement data you want. So you can actually put in 312.5 millimeters in the width scaling. And when I click enter, it scales that whole image. Sorry, let me go back. So it scales, if I go back to undo that, it scales the whole content to my right width. So by using that one instead, you can scale content as well. Yeah, so these ones are EPS files, I think. Let me double check that. Or they are just Illustrator files. Yes, you can use full Illustrator files, you can use PDF files, you can use EPS. Either of them are perfectly fine. Sorry? That also works. Yeah, so you can, that's a very good point. If you have a montage, you can place that in and it becomes a reference to another InDesign file. So that's absolutely works equal well. So for editing possibilities, it's the best to retain them as Illustrator and InDesign. And if you want to do adjustment in that file, you have your links dialog here. So in the links, you can then see all of those placed images. And you see that correctly, this is a Illustrator file, .ai. And I can right click on that one and, sorry, just scale this out a little bit. And you can say edit with Illustrator, or because this is the default, you can then just click edit. And then it goes into this one and I can do my fine adjustments on this here and save that. And then it's a live link. So when I click back, it updates. And this is now updated also in that preview. So I can quickly do that small adjustments in there as well. So what if you have done a cropping like this? If I crop this in a scale-wise manner and I scale this up to my 312.5 like this. So I have now done my cropping and scaling and I'm happy with the text box or the box of this. But I want all my original data to fit into that box. Then you have a command called fitting. And the fitting of here can be done in two ways. So if you go to object fitting, you can fit the content to the frame, or you can fit the frame to the content. And it's just as it sounds. If you would fit the frame to the content, it fits there. It increases my frame to encapsulate the whole content. But as I said before, I like the size of my frame. I just want the content to shrink into that frame. Then you can use the fitting command again. But then say fill frame proportionally, fit content proportionally, and fit framed content there. So what this means is that what you normally want to use is this fit content proportionally. And then it just scales it all in, but it doesn't skew the image data in there. So if your content would be square, but your frame oblong, this one will just fit the height of it. So it would leave space on the side. So there you can play around with this, but it's a good tool to make you go back to making sure that all your original data is in here. And that can be difficult to see, especially on this side here, if you have actually put in all of that again. But by the fitting command, then that works very well. There were other questions in InDesign that I had before. Let me just double check which other questions you had there. Yes. Yes, so in here, in my Word document, I actually had that the title was already in that document. So here my plan was to use this as the title for that image. And so you can either do like that, or you go to the text tool and you just pull out a new text box. And then you can write your title into that one. So there are many different alternatives on how to do that. Yes, I can do that. And that you do in the layout. You have margins and columns. And there you can, so these are live, so you can actually enable layout adjustments there. And now you can start to expand these columns or the gutter in between. And it's a bit intelligent, so that you see if you enable layout adjustments, you see that the things that are put in my columns is actually shrinking with the columns itself. So this image that was one column wide is also shrinking with that. So it's if you click that enable layout adjustments, you can now go in and fine tune this without having to go back and update all the sizes of the things that are in between. So that can save you a lot of time also if you figure out in the end that your separation of your columns was too wide, for example. To view your layout in a good way, all of these frames and things are really in the way when you want to see the final layout. And now, of course, this poster looks awful at this point, but you may want to see that overview. And you have down in this corner your preview mode. And you see that now it's working in normal. And when you go up over to preview, what happens is that it now is throwing away everything that's outside your printed area. And it's also hiding all of these boxes. So now you can see how the visual appearance should look on that poster. And this, combined with the high quality display performance, will give you the closest approximation of how this always will look in the end. So that's another thing is good to step back and forth in between. You can still work with everything in here, but you don't see all of these column guides and everything else in there. Any other questions on InDesign at this point?
Well, is there some other way? If you, for example, import graphics in a composite picture, is there some other way to adjust the font size to make them all the same? Or
now it's a challenge because they are only linked. The original file, it doesn't know how big it's going to be reproduced in the other one. So So there's no good way of linking font sizes between your linked file and the final one. So the only way you can do it is to do like this, that it, when you're finished, and say with this image, you say this is the final size of that image. If you click on the center of this one, now this is not so obvious here. Let me see if I can go in and make that one a bit more obvious. Sorry, I'll just zoom in here. So say that I had the internal image here to be cropped so that it should be this size. When you click the center, this focusing ring, now you're looking at the original image. And then you see that your original image, as it looks here, it's reproduced in 143.5% of its original. So what I would do is I would decide on a font size, and I would then go back to my linked file and divide that with this number, 1.43. So then I know that when it's scaled up 143%, it will look... So if I want the final font size to be 12, I would go into my linked file, take 12 points divided by 1.43, and then get that size. So it's a bit of the math of scaling to that. But then it only works when placed in that content. So you may not want to change your original. But I think that's the only way you can make sure that all your fonts are the same, all your line thicknesses are the same, is to look at what's the final scaling of that linked file. I wish there was a better way, but I don't see that. But it's a very valid point, because normally you may have your graphs being small for a paper, and you pull them up and your lettering will be too big, and your the line thickness will be too big as well. So other questions on InDesign. InDesign is normally quite a straightforward application to work with. I think the key is to work with styles a lot and different layouts. And one thing with layout that is useful in a multi-page, yes, sorry.
So if you want to change the text of your word link text.
Yes.
Can you do that directly in InDesign?
Yeah. So now...
No,
you're not changing the original file. So now you have two alternatives. One is just, because this is text, I can now go back and take away this. And now it's updated from the original. But it doesn't change your original Word file. So if you want to put in a new reference in the Word file, you would go back to Word, and then you would go to the poster text there. And then here, I can now change something else here. If I don't want the is created instead of engineered, but say that I would have done something else. Now, because I have my styles, I can just select that whole text and replace it with the updated text file from Word. And now, if I just show the import options again, it will say that it uses the InDesign style definition for all those styles. So when I place that, it actually now has updated that text in here, but all the styles retained from InDesign. What it did was, now because this has now made it a little bit longer, I have to just reflow that one. But otherwise, everything is...
You did a change in InDesign.
Yes, so you see my change in InDesign is replaced. So the one I took away, the DHFR here, that's replaced with the Word, because I placed in the Word again. So if you do changes in text after it has been placed in InDesign, then they are not saved back to the text file. So you have to sort of either decide on, I do all my changes in Word, or I do all my changes in InDesign. The combination is not good, at least for in one. For a poster, it may not be as important to do all the changes in Word, but for grant applications, thesis, or other very long text files, it's much better to work with it in Word and just replace and refill in the InDesign. Because InDesign is quite a cumbersome text writing tool, and it doesn't have these reference handling software and other things.
You have replaced the file like this, but
yes.
You do the same like with the figures, like just relink.
Yes, absolutely. So then you have the tool that you mark the figure, and you go to your links, and you have these tools down here. So from the right side, you have the edit tool. Sorry, this one says edit original, and you open in Illustrator. The other ones here is that you want to show the link where it is in the document, and then it goes to, well, sorry, it's just too zoomed in. And it marks that link here. If I go to another one and say go to link, it shows which file it is. But the last one here is relink. So if I just take this one and say, no, I don't want that one, I want to relink it to something completely different, I could go to the desktop and use my document, this maybe intermediate PDF file, and place that one instead. So then it puts in a different image within that same box. So it retains the box, but now the scaling of the image that I replaced there could be very different. So that's where Fit Content to Frame is a good tool then to bring this in here. So then it fits it proportionally within that whole frame. So there you can always switch between different revisions of your image file or other things like that. One thing more I wanted to show that's not relevant to posters is when you have a multi-page file. So when you have a multi-page file, you can choose to have facing pages and say that I want to make a document that's 10 A4 and has sort of 1-inch margins there. When you have a multi-page file, there are two things you will see. One is that down here, sorry if I scale this in, here you can now choose and jump to any page you want. Or you can use this one to go to the next spread. And the spread is then the left and right pages because they are facing. So this is made to become a book. And when you have this multi-page document, you also have in this page dialog what's called your masters. And the masters are the templates that are added to each page. So you see here that all these pages have the capital letter A in them. And that means that they have the A master applied to them. So if I do like this, that I create a text box, and I want to have it down here. And in this text box, I want to put in my page number. So what I do is in type, I have these insert special characters. Sorry, you need to be in the text editing here. So you actually write text in it. So we can call it page, colon, and then you can put in these special characters. And then we should see, where are they? Current page number, yes. So now it puts in which page number this should be. So you can either put this one in here, and I may just go to making this to the right here. So I create something that puts a page number. You see it calls it page number 2, and that's because I put it on page number 2. But in any other page, like page number 3 or 4, it's not there anymore. But if I take this whole box, cut it out, and go to my A master, and double click on that, and place it in, you now see that it calls this page A. And that means that this is now put on all the left pages. So when I go to page 2, I have it. Now to page 4, I also have that one. So in your page masters, you can put in all the things that you want to have as headers and footers. The advantage with InDesign compared to Word is that you can work with many masters. So I can actually go to my A master here, and I can say that I want to make a new master. So I may then call that B. And in B, I may want to have no page number, or maybe let's just say, for example, here I can put the page number in the center. And then you now can decide which page you want to have A master and B master. So the B, I may want to have only on page 4. And then you see that on page, sorry, maybe I actually did not copy, I probably cut the page number. So I'll just go back here and paste that. So now you see on page 2, I have my page number, and on page 4, I managed to delete it. Sorry, the copy paste is a difficult command, apparently. Yeah, now I have it on both. So now you can see that on page 2, I have it on the left, and on page 4, I have it center. So there you can work with both having the text boxes that flow differently, page numbers, headings, many different things that can be for your different sections. And these sections can also be numbered differently. You can go in here and say that I want to change my page number in only from this page here. And then you go to numbering, and I say I want to start a new section at this page where it should be called number 1 again. So then it makes a new page that starts with number 1 at that. So you can have your first section could be called with the Roman letters, and then you can numbering, and then you can have Arabic numbering later on in your documents like this as well. So that helps you when you create longer, more complex documents to make that look unified. Right, I think those were the things I wanted to take in InDesign. So next, we go into the more fancy things. And there were a couple of questions that came to in the advanced tools of InDesign. And one thing I wanted to start with is just to discuss a little bit on gradients and 3D looks and these kind of things, because that came up this morning that we had a lot of nice gradients, but I wanted to show some other alternatives on working with 3D that may aid it to look almost the same way, but making many, many fewer objects and making much less complex. So when you have a circle like this, to make it into a sphere, it's now it just looks like a very flat sheet. But there are simple ways that you can make this look into much more of a 3D version. And one alternative is to work with a specular highlight. So a specular highlight could be just in the very most simple way. It could look like this snooker ball. So just by putting something white like this, when you scale it down, you may get sort of an artificial interpretation of this being a little bit more 3D. It's not the most spectacular you have seen. And by making this not completely white, you fool your eye to think that this may be a little bit of 3D. The next level up from that is just to increase this to look a bit more glossy. And that trick you can do then is to start changing this highlight view. So when you have that circle, you can then just modify the bottom of this a little bit to go up like this and increase the size of that one. So now you make a specular highlight that looks a little bit like this is actually a round ball. So then you have just two objects that give you a little bit more of a 3D feeling to it. The next level from that is another tool that I wanted to show you, which is called Blend. And Blend tool is a tool that can make you make gradients from one object to another one. And it works in the way that you select your start object and your final object like this. And then you select the Blend tool. And then you have to select from which point of the outer object to which point in the inner object you want this to blend. And for this to look good, you want to have the same number of points in your outer object and your inner object. So if I link these two just by clicking the outer point there and the inner one, there. Now you see it makes a gradient that goes from the outer object shape into the inner. And this may be difficult to see how it does that, but it actually does it in many steps. And you can go into blend and blend options. And now you can say that I don't want this to be smooth, but I want to specify the number of steps. And you see, to make this into a smooth blend, it needs 210 objects per these. And when you scale these down and say you want to make part of your membrane, lipid membrane, you may have hundreds of these. And then it's 100 times 210 here. It can easily become many thousand objects. So what you want to make sure is that you don't waste more objects per these than you actually need to. So you can make this into, say that you have 8 different individual steps. So then it doesn't, so it makes the same thing, but have these individual steps in. And you can actually double click into this. And when you double click into a complex object like this, you see that up here, you're now editing within the blend. And when you're editing within the blend, I can now pull this one out. And you see that that's now still a live blend. So I see all of these individual objects within there and how it morphs from this circle into this more of kidney-shaped structure. So that can be a very simple way for you to make a highlight without making these very complex gradients. And in this case, I may not want to start with the red, but I'll just skip my gradient and I say I want to make something a bit of a dark yellow that goes into a light yellow specular highlight. And I'll just want to have this as a simple blend. So I may want to have these just 4 steps. And you'll see later on why every next step will be quite costly. So you want to have very few steps. So you see when this is big like this, it doesn't look that great. But if I scale that down to maybe the final size where I want it, this looks indistinguishable from a gradient. So just by doing that, you have gone down 50-fold in your number of objects, but retaining the same final print quality. And why is that important? Well, this I thought could be the beginning on how you can work with pattern brushes. And what is a pattern brush? Well, the pattern brush is a tool that puts a shape repeated along a path. And that's actually quite optimal if you want to make a lipid membrane. So I thought I could show you the example of how to create a lipid membrane. I just want to make sure that the line width of this may just be 0.2 points there. So I just made this to be a little bit dominant outside. The should go out of that one. So you see that arrow, when you're in a blend, you can easily forget that you're inside and then whatever you move just destroys your image. But if you double click outside, this heading up there goes away. So then when you have this one, you can now easily just say, well, it's a bilayer, so I want to make sure that they are 2 below each other, but I want to have the specular highlight to the same direction. And I may just draw the inner just by hand like this. And when you've done that, you may see that I don't like the shape that I draw down here. The pen tool is intelligent in the way that it realizes when you want to redraw something. So if I think that this bend is too sharp, I just start drawing over it like this, and it updates that part. So you can redraw out, and then you can sort of go in and fine-tune this part. And it's quite difficult to draw with the pad, so just have to forgive me for this not looking excellent, but then you can just go in and say that I want the edges round on this one. So let's just make this a very simple lipid, put these ones to the back like that, and just group these, and I make a copy of them and just move them around. So I know that my these are looking symmetrical. And the key thing you want to make sure here is that you want to have it all being symmetrical over the center. So the center in the middle of all of this here should be where your line will go through. And I'll make that clearer later on. And you'll just make sure that all of these are aligned along the same axis. So I'll just move that one up there. And this lipid layer, I want it just to have a light blue inner. And so you create a box in there that is then perfectly aligned like this with, say, a very light blue color there. And I put this one to the back. What I know from previously is that it's very important that this has the same outer width as this ball. And it isn't like that because this line is now 0.2 points, and this one doesn't have a line. So what you can do is to your width, and this is where I wanted to show also that you can mix also in your additions. So I to these 6.4 millimeters, I can actually add plus 0.2 points. So it's millimeter plus points, and I add those. And you see that it then is increasing this one, although I don't want the height to increase as well. Plus 0.2 points. So then I've moved it so that it's perfectly on the outside of this line as well. And you'll see later on why that's important. So what I've created now is just a very simple unit of a full lipid bilayer. And that's, so we just say group there. And I can think about this being a little bit too big, but I don't care about that right now. So then you select that whole group and you go into this called brushes. And within brushes, I can now make a new brush. So I have this selected and I call this a pattern brush. So a pattern brush has five different parts of them. So you have the part being on a normal line, you have an outer corner, an inner corner, the starting point and the end point. And these can be different symbols. So you can have a rounded corner in each end, and I'll show you that when working with DNA, for example, how that can look nice in the end. So now I've created my own personal lipid bilayer brush. And then I can just make a normal path. So I'll just make this black and white, and I'll go into my normal pen tool, and I write, just draw a smooth, but it can be a little bit rounded, like this, path. Sorry, something like that. And then I just select that one and select my pen. And now I created this very fluid lipid bilayer that you can then reuse. And then you can go in here and just say that in my brush options, you may want to scale this down. So you can now scale it to be the size where you want it. So here you see that now this is where it comes to the point where you want to make sure that you have few objects within it, because you can easily here create a couple of thousand copies of the same object.
Yes.
So this new brush, is this saved on the program or in the file?
It's only saved in this file. So what you want to do then is that you can actually go in, let me see how you do that, and you should be able to save brush library. Then you can make your own libraries of these things. So that's a single simple brush. How about if you want to make something that has different ends? And your alternative there is, so you want to start with something very simple if you want to make a DNA, for example. So this is made just a very simple line. And what this has done is, as you may see, it just has a starting point, an end point, and then using this line width tool to expand the center of it. It is nothing more than that. And then it's just being put together to be fully symmetrical. And to make that into a pattern, you may also want to have starts and ends. So I just created here a bit of a fancy looking start and end of your small DNA molecule. And this you can play around with how much as you want. You just want to make sure that the width of your center part, which is this one, the top to bottom, is identical to your two ends. Because if the height is not the same, they will not fit nicely together when you make a pattern brush. So then, if you have all of these, you have the parts you need to create your DNA brush. And I'll just show you this a little bit smaller. So when you have your start, middle, and end, you may say, well, I want to squeeze this one a little bit to make my DNA go a little bit more wobbly. But so then you just maintain this as three objects. And this, I think, can be good for you to look at later on also in the recording. So you start with your center one, that one you want to be along a path. And then from that one, you create your new brush. And this is, again, a pattern brush. And I say OK. And there, I can call this one DNA. And I just say OK. So now I've created a pattern brush that is just my DNA. So it has open start and edges. But from that, you may actually want to add these fancy ends to it. And that's where I said you have in this brush options, you have your outer corner, your inner corner, and your end points, your start and the finish. And they are in this order. It's not very sort of simple to see, but it's actually so that here you have your line, your corners, and these are your start and finish. So that's where you want your other objects to move in as well. So if I take this first object, you need to press the Alt button, and then you pull it into here. And then you see that that's added as the start of this line. And you say OK, and you apply it to the stroke. And now you see I have a start on this. And then you do the same thing on the other end here. Alt button pressed, move it into there. And I may say that I want this one to be something like this. And I apply to. So now I've created a very simple ribbon that has these start and ends. But it's still a live path. So I can go in and modify this and make it go very wobbly like this. And it updates and it moves smoothly along that one. So that's a very useful one to work with DNA. But if you want this to really look like DNA, you want to make sure that they are not fully symmetrical with the two strands. So you want to work with it a little bit to be more DNA. But just to show you how a simple pattern can be made like this with a stroke. The patterns are not only limited to lines. So when you have something like this lipid bilayer, you may want to also create something that is looking like the top of your lipids. So I'll just get this sphere out. So to make something that looks a bit 3D, I actually want to go into this and even reduce this blend a little bit more. So I may only have three ones here. And because of that, it's the reason is that you generate so many of these in this tool that I will show you. So when you have this one, you can now go into Window and Pattern Options. So what is a pattern? Well, the pattern can be generated of any symbol. The only constraint you have is that it cannot contain gradients. It's the same thing with the pattern brush, that you cannot have normal gradients in them. I don't know the reason for this, but it just says that it contains objects that cannot be used as brushes. So skip any gradients within your brushes or patterns. But when you have this in the Window Pattern Options, you can now say, I want to make a pattern. And then it says that it's adding a new pattern into your swatch library there. So now it replicates this same sphere in this totally symmetrical pattern. But this doesn't have to be a grid like this. You can put it as bricks like this. And what I can then say is that, well, they should be side to side in the horizontal axis, but I want them to overlap in the vertical axis. So I may just put three like this. So now it has the overlap of all these objects. And then I can change here to have the overlap so that they are looking like they are behind each other. So now I have created this pattern tool that is looking like these spheres behind each other here. And then you can just exit this pattern editing mode. And I've created myself now a new pattern. To make this look good to that lipid, you may then want to go back to this one, brushes, double click here, and say that this should be, again, 100%. So I just make that into a large lipid bilayer. And then next to that one, I can now just create any type of box. I'll just move these ones out for now. And so I can create just a box here that can be behind that lipid. And I'll just make the filling black and move this to the back. And then to that one, you can now add the pattern that I made. So now you have made it looking a bit more like a lipid layer. So these are tools you can play around with, but you see you can easily generate way too complex images. And when you have this very sort of symmetrical pattern, you want to make sure that, of course, you don't use this in way too large areas. So you may want to make sure that this is just showing a small part of that layer, but it may help you to give this look and feel. So next we have 10 minutes before coffee, and I thought I could go in a little bit to the 3D effects that are in Illustrator as well. And these are also, again, tools you should use carefully, not to make it too fancy looking and complex, but they can be nice to use in some areas. And the first thing you can look at is how to rotate a flat object. And there you may want to just start with something very simple and say, well, I'll make my capital B again and say this could be Garamond, and it could be, what do we think, 60 points. Okay, so I just make this big B. And when you have this, any object, you can go into the effects with 3D and rotate. And this 3D rotation tool looks the same for many different things. And when I turn on the preview here, you see that it starts to rotate this in a three-dimensional space. So the front of this cube is where the B is sort of placed in space. And you can go up and you can rotate it down so that it looks like it's tilting. And this you can play around with exactly how much you want. But the advantage is that this is actually a live object again. So it's still a B. So I can here go in and say, well, I want this to read hello instead. And I've made now a 3D object of my hello. So this makes it very easy for you to... Sorry, just make sure that goes. So what you can do with that is then to just have two of these objects, put them behind each other, and make the sort of 3D looking effects that are still manageable to edit. So you can just edit this text again. So that's a very simple way to work with 3D. When working with 3D, you see that you have these objects here, but you may want to go in and fine-tune this later on. You see that this H isn't really sitting where I want it. Then you mark this and go to expand appearance. This is the one we discussed earlier on as well today. And when you expand the appearance, you stop having that one as a 3D object. And the background, you can do the same way. So now they're lost as 3D object, but now you can go in and you can select here each of these points. And you can start to then fine-tune that. So you can do the rough initial adjustment in the 3D, and once you're happy with that, go into a 2D mode. So if I've done this and I'm not happy with the 3D effect, how can I get back and adjust that? And that's in something here called appearance. And in the appearance toolbox, you see for each object that you mark, what has been done to this object. And you see that this object is a character type, and I have put a 3D rotate on it. So when double clicking on that, I can now go back and I can space this one. So then I can move it around and change it again. So my 3D is not locked just because I put it in. And this is now looking mostly like word art. This is not something you may want to use in your illustrations. It's just a simple way to show you how a simple 3D can look. But you, with this one, you can actually start to make something that can look quite interesting as well. Yes. So you can think about extruding and 3D also with other quite complex shapes. And the 3D is not just limited to rotating text in 3D. It can actually start to generate extrusion in depth, but also in circular. So here, you may not believe this, but this is actually the starting point for an erythrocyte. And why do I say that? Well, if you take two of these guys and put them next to each other like this, this is your central cut, roughly, of a blood cell. So you want to think about how do they look when I cut them through, and have that as your starting point. And then I can go in with this shape, again in the 3D effects, and I say that I want to revolve. And what it does then is, when I click this one, is to make the 3D outline of that one. And then you can rotate this like this, and you can get different erythrocytes that way. And you can play around with your camera perspective a little bit and get something that looks a bit more like a erythrocyte. And so you can put these next to each other and just by that simple tool make a small group of blood cells. And this can also be used if you want to generate something in your lipid bilayer. Where did I put that? Here. So you may want to have now a channel that goes through this. And I'll just, for these here, make a new layer and put a new one here. So what I start with, if I want to make a channel, is just, I'll make it there, something that looks roughly like, so I think about my this channel on the outside and inside here. How do I want it to look? Well, maybe the inside should be a bit higher than the outside, and here, something like that. It really doesn't have to look very perfect. You just make a shape that could look roughly like a channel. And once you do that, you can give it, this can be a very nice colorful blue. Just make this a very Swedish drawing. And once you have that, you can now go back into the 3D revolve. And with revolve, you don't need to have it full 360. You can actually have this to be only 180 degrees and preview that. And now you see I've made a channel that may start to look good, but it doesn't have an opening in the middle. So what you want to do is to say that I want to have this maybe, 12 points offset in the center. And it's now a very sort of simple shape of a channel that goes through this. And what's the beauty of that is that then you can go back with this channel, say that, well, I want now to make this into the top of a channel. So I just delete the lower two versions here and make that into a sharp angle there. What's the idea? So you can make this here into a flat receptor top. And then I go back to my appearance and double click the 3D revolve and say that this one should be 360. So now I've created the top of the receptor that I can then put, so it's on top of this bilayer there. So you can, with this simple 3D, just make something that looks like the top of a transporter or a channel or a receptor and these other things. So these are sort of simple 3D tools that you can use as well. So I just had two small tools left that I wanted to tell you a little bit about. And one thing is a very simple thing that may be annoying if you don't know it. And that's when you have a shape that has either patterns in it, or let me just show this one with a stroke that you have a stroke width like this. So when transforming shapes in Illustrator, you have two options. And they are decided in this tool here. So in the transform menu, you have something called scale strokes and effects. And normally this is not checked by default, if I remember correctly. And what that means is that your stroke will always be the same width, regardless on how you scale this. So now this is stroke is 18. And when I scale this box down, you will see it's still 18. And in some cases, this is clearly what you want. And in other cases, you want it to scale with your sizing. So then you just go back here and say scale strokes and effects. And now when I scale this one down, it scales the line width proportionally. And it does that also with any filling you have. So that's a good thing to know. Another tool that I find useful is when you want to divide an object. So let's say that this object here, if I just make this into, say that this is in a graph, and you just have this 2 points width, and this is too high compared to, let's say, my second one here, and I want to, so here you see that you didn't want to have that scale strokes and effects, so I'll just take that away, and you scale that one down. So you may want to cut this long column down. And the tool you can use is something called divide below. So what I just do like this is to generate two lines like this. And then I select one of the lines and choose in path, divide objects below. So what it did was just to cut this background object into two. And I can do the same thing with the other one here, and path, divide objects below. So now I've created this, and then you can go in here in the middle. And this is another thing I wanted to show, that when you have something like this shape, if I pull it out, and I want to reshape this, I want to make this thinner, but I don't want it to change the angle. So if I would pull this one up, you see the angle changes as well. But I want to maintain the same angle, but not make it as thick. What you can do then is just with the direct selection tool, select the line that you want to change. And it has actually doesn't show you that that line is selected, but it is. So then I can either with my arrows pull this one downwards or upwards like this, or I can pull it with this arrow. And then you see that it only pulls that line and keeps the other lines in between. And the combination of arrow and shift makes you able to pull this up and down like that. So that is then what you can do here is to pull that one down and this one up. And you have created a very simple version of separating an object like that. So that's the divide below, divide objects below, and than using the direct arrow to modify objects. So now I thought we could go into other questions, if you have any energy left to have any questions. Or we have covered everything. Yes. Excellent. Good that you asked that. So it's actually very simple. So you can either put it on a path, like this, or have a regular line. So in Illustrator, each line has a start and a finish. It's not easy to see which one is which, but it will be important when you have your arrowheads, which one is your start and your finish. So in your stroke tool, if you hide your options, you have very few options, but when you show the options, you get all these extra functions. Most simple function is the dashed line, and many of you have found that, I hope, that you can create how many dashes you want in that one, and I can create it a bit different so that I have long, short, long, and these sort of very different shapes on my dashed line that I can easily do. But below that, you also have your arrowheads. So you have an arrowhead in your start point, and you can decide exactly which one of these it should be. So just take a simple one, and it goes in this side. And then in the other end, you can choose to have the same type of arrow, or you can have these type of things that are maybe inhibitory version on that side. So this, you see, it knows which is your start and the end, but you can actually flip them with this tool here and swap starts and end. So then you can redirect to the other side. And then it's actually directly related to the width of your stroke. So you see, when I increase my width of my stroke, I increase the size of this arrowhead. And then, so you may end up with, in a case that you say that this arrowhead becomes way too large, then you have the scaling option here. And then you can go down to scale this one down, and I want to say that this arrowhead here should only be 40%. Then, 140 shouldn't be, just 40%. So. Then you can see that now the point of this arrow is at the end of the line. And you have down here that either the point can be, or the start of this can be at the end of the line. So dependent on how you work with your lines, you may want to have it that it actually ends up at pointing to the end of the line, or that starts there, like this. So that's how to do arrows. And they can be bent and straight and everything like that, just by using this tool.
One thing that is about InDesign. Mm-hmm. We were talking about when you are trying to do the poster, and you have all your phones in the big part, but you want to have big typo on the top, not with colors.
Yes.
You have to create two different.
So, what you can do there is you have a couple of different alternatives. So if we just create one more that is times, just make it the same one, and make this into four columns, what did we say 50 millimeters there, and this one, what did we have, 40, something like that. So the first thing to say is that you're not locked into having text boxes that are fitting in one column. You can let one text box flow all through all of them. So that's the absolutely easiest thing, is to make that go through all. So when working with our sort of traditional layout of a poster, I would do like this, that I actually change my top margin. So I change this to maybe be 240 millimeters. So I move that one down, and then I can use this top to align to there, and then I have my area for the title. So that's the absolutely easiest way. But you're never locked into your columns just because they are there. They're just helping you to guide.
And you can check the size of this column quickly, like in the case that you want to create an image and put exactly the same.
So there are probably quick tools. What I normally use is just that your text boxes will fit perfectly. So I just check what it says up here. In your text box, how wide that is, and that is your full column. So that's what I do. There may be other quicker ways to do it, but that's what I normally do. Right.
So how would you draw text boxes? Mm-hmm. When we draw, like when you put in your text and you want to have a box on it, Would you draw that box then in Illustrator and take it in?
I know you were speaking about rounded cornered boxes before. So how do you do a round cornered box? And let's make this just into a black box. Sorry, let's see here. If I can zoom in here so we can see this box there. And we have this box with, say, a bit wider edge like this. So you can then go in and say corner options of this box. And then when you have that, you can decide exactly how your corners should look. They are something called fancy, which I don't know if I think it's very fancy, but anyway, that's so you can have this type of squiggly ones, or you can make them just rounded like this. So there you decide on your diameter of each corner, and then you have a rounded box like that. So you normally don't need to import objects just because of that. And also the same thing in Illustrator, you have the possibility to do your arrows here as well. And you have them in the same place in the stroke dialogue. You have all of these start and end arrows. The nuisance in InDesign is that you cannot do many of the changes to your arrows as you can in Illustrator. You can't change the size of the arrowhead. You cannot flip orientation of them. So you have a little bit more freedom when doing arrows in Illustrator compared to InDesign, but you can do small and quick arrows also in InDesign. Yes.
My question is about Illustrator and gradients. So when I was doing my illustration, I noticed that sometimes when I was trying to change the gradient in a shape, it changed the gradient in a stroke instead. So is there a way to block or to change between strokes?
Yes. So it all has to do with which one you select in this tool here. So in all of them, sorry, I must have clicked again. So in every tool where you select these things, you have the one that you are working on right now. So you have the fill or the stroke. So if I click the stroke, this one moves to the front. And then it means that you're changing the gradient in the stroke. And then when you click in this one, you're changing the gradient in the fill. So you just need to quickly check this one before you change your gradient, and then that will solve it.
And about the changing of the colors in the gradient?
Yes. So that's another thing that can be difficult. And normally it's difficult because you don't have your palettes out. So as you remember, you can always go back and reset all your palettes. So yeah, I normally start by resetting them, and then I take my gradient and just pull this one out. And then I take my colors. So either I work with the color palette, and then I pull this one out and just show my options, or I would use the swatches and I pull that one out as well. What you don't want is them to automatically go back in. That's where it normally becomes difficult. So then I have this object. I click a gradient just to get started. And now you have two different options when coloring. One of them is just drag and drop. So I can take this color and I say that I want to have that in there. And then it replaces the color in there. And then the yellow one on top of here. The other version is that you click one of these and you see that the arrowhead on that one becomes black. You can see that in here. So this one is black, and then if I click this one instead, it's black. And when that's marked, then actually whatever you change up in this one will affect that color. So when I move that one down, it moves this to black. So you can fine tune that color in the gradient, and you can also change the opacity only on this one, saying that I want this to be totally transparent. And then it changes only that one. And just another point there is that your transparency sits with your color if you want to there. So you can have these sort of working together, and then you see that it comes these small squigglies below is that you've changed the opacity of this point. Did that answer your question?
have a question how you can, if you already draw like something, and how you can add a line to that so that I can, like, to this point or to this ankle point, add like another line. I had problems with that.
So yeah, that's a good question in two ways. So it may be so that I have one line that is sitting like this, and I have another line that is like this, and I want to make this into one object. So what's your options to do that? The first way is actually to use the pen tool. And when you see here, see if you can see that, when I come to this anchor, it changes. So now it has a star, meaning that it will create a new object. But if it comes to this one, you see it becomes a straight line. And then it actually is building on top of this previous object. And you can then pull it here, and it changes into this symbol that means that it will join. So then when I move that one there, I've actually joined these objects through a smooth path. So now it's a smooth path in between those two. The other version you can do is to take the direct selection tool and actually move your anchor point here. And when I move this on top of the other one, it snaps on like this, meaning that they are perfectly on top of each other. And when they are like that, then I can click outside, drag over, so I select only these two anchor points, and right click on it. And then I have something called join. And when I do that, it joins these two into a single point. So these are two ways to join objects together. And now this is one single object that I can fill. So then I can switch this one, and it's a single one. So, other questions?
And this is a problem when sometimes you get this
Yes, very good point. So if you have an object, see if I can mimic this. So if you have a square like this with lines, and I move a corner in to make this into a very pointed space up here. So what you see in this type of thing is that it has a blunt end. And why it has a blunt end and not a very tipped end there is because you have something called the limit of the line. So if I just see if I can show this in magnification, I'll just move these guys up like this. So if I magnify this, you see that now it has a pointed line. But when I move this one in, it at a certain level, it cuts this off. So now you see it become a blunt line there, a blunt top. And this has to do with, if you go into your stroke and show options here, you have a limit called 10 times here. And so if I decrease this limit or increase it to 100, you see that that tip comes back. So by changing the limit, you can say, how long is this allowed to go out before I cut it? So that's this is sort of showing the opposite effect. So when you have that effect, what you just go in is either you go in and say that I want all my corners to be blunted, and I do that in here. So I just bevel the corner, and then you don't need a limit at all. Or I retain this one, but I may say that this one should only be 5. And then it makes this limit on top of it.
So if you have a complex shape, and you want to, there's something called like offset, which you can, if you want to make additional one figure that is just in all the lines, there's a little bit.
Just shifted, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah, that's a good question. So the there are two different scenarios. I can see this, that this can be a useful question. So one is if you have, it could be a circle. So you have a circle like this, and you want to make one outside that one. What I would do is to copy and paste in front and then you have the new one, and you can scale it out by the transform. So that's the easiest way of saying that I want this to be 2 millimeters outside, so I just add +4 to my diameter. Sorry, with this one in the center. So I just do this one +4 millimeters. So that's the easiest way if you just want to have something outside. If you have a path that looks more like this, and you want to have it to the right of that. So one option is that you actually make the path 12, and if you want to have it 12 points spaced, and go to path and outline stroke. And once you have the stroke outline, you can delete the top and the bottom of that. Sorry, just clicking this one. So then you have created two objects that flow with the same spacing. And the third version is, of course, if you just want to have it shifted in one direction or the other, I would use exactly as I did with the circle and paste in front on the same place and just move it by the transform.
But I think if you go to object, path, how does this offset work?
Good question.
Because I can only get it to increase. I mean, if I have a more complex shape than just a circle, I cannot just add to the...
Very good question. I have never used that one. It seems to work well in a circle, as you say. And it just creates a copy just as I did before. But when you say you have a line like this one, I don't know how it would work with that one if you do path offset path. Okay, so it makes offset to both sides. So you mean you don't want it to be on both sides or... on an object?
If I just want to decrease, for example, because
then
I wouldn't make it.
No, but I see your point. It may not be with a complex shape like this, but if you would decrease it in size, I would myself probably use the paste in front and reduce the size. But this would have been more elegant in that case, I would agree. Can't you just do this one? It seems like it does one on the outside and one on the inside, and delete the outside version? It may work. But I've never used that one, actually. Right.
Just remind me, please, if you want to insert some objects, some drawings, some picture, whatever, was that the place?
Yes, exactly. It's a place command. And it's available in both Illustrator and InDesign, but it's much more functional in InDesign than it is in Illustrator. It's more limited in Illustrator, especially when you use pixel-based graphics that you can't crop and do things in the way that you would expect to do in InDesign. But you can place with that command in both, or drag and drop. Drag and drop also works well. So if you have say like this object and you pull it in, it actually pulls that one in here directly, and you get all those objects. So with that. That also works.
We will create a new layer, or where will it end up?
So no, it never creates a new layer by default. What you can do is when you place a new one, and you just say that I want to place, and I choose, just take this one, and I place it as a link, then it's selectable as one object, and I can go to layers, new layer, and arrange send this to current layer. And then I've moved it to its own layer. But it's not in its own layer by default. It's just placing it in. And then you see this is still as an embedded link. But if you go then to flatten the transparency, this will then be embedded into this one. Interesting. It didn't work on that file. But that's normally the way you would do it.
You said something about tips for transparency.
Yes, that's true. So we can go back a little bit on the transparency. Let me think what I had in mind. Let's see if I can find that one. Let's just go, let's take something. So this is an example of one thing I wanted to bring up is how you can work with transparencies within drawings. And this has two effects that I thought I could bring up. And one of them is, sorry, let me just unlock that layer. One of them is called gradient meshes. So what is a gradient mesh? So when you see this head, it has a bit more of a complex gradient within it. You have the highlight up in the top of the skull here. And it also has a bit of an advanced transparency in it. And what the transparency is not obvious now, but if I just make a blue and put this in front, you can see that it has sort of a hole in the head, and that's to show the basal ganglia in the injection like this. So this is done in two parts. The first part, if I just go in and disable the transparency, the opacity mask, is this gradient mesh. And a gradient mesh is actually, think about it as the blend function we were doing before. But it actually puts in points in your objects where you can start to change the dynamics of the coloring. So if I select this point, I can now go in and say this should be grayscale, and I can darken there. And you see it darkens at that point, but sort of going smooth gradients out to the rest. And this can be used, it's the way when you see people like the muscle guy in the drawing from the Nobel Prize, they use a lot of these gradient meshes to bring out muscles and shapes. And this you can really make as advanced as you want. If you want to see good descriptions of this, there are some amazing YouTube clips on how to do that. But the gradient mesh is the tool that is down here. And with this tool, you actually put in points within a flat shape like this. And when I put in one point, I now have put a coloring point here. So it doesn't change anything else in your object, but it adds this coloring possibility. So then I can change the color on that point. And you see it makes this soft gradient dependent on where this point is. And I can move this one, this point, to be over here. And you start to see that this can now look quite sort of dramatic in these gradients like that. So you can make very advanced soft gradients with this gradient mesh tool. And that's exactly what was done in this image here, is to just add a specular highlight, so to say, on the top of the skull and just making this point brighter than the background. And it gives much more of a smooth and organic gradient that goes all the way down here and out. So that is one part of the where you can make these advanced transparencies, because you can also use this gradient mesh. So just make a start with a black box and make a gradient to white. That's the easiest way to start. And we can just make this a little bit more interesting like this. So, and then I can use this as a opacity mask for, let's make it for something else. Let's try this one. Make mask. And I just place this one in there. It worked for me yesterday evening when I was thinking about how to show this. Interesting. It's typical when you want to show something a little bit different. Right. So let me just see if I can make a normal mask work. Yeah, I can with that. So it may be so that it's not pasting it correctly. So now I put in a white, and in there putting my gradient mesh and making that point into black. So then it works. Apparently you can't copy a gradient mask into a gradient mesh into an opacity mask. Don't ask me why, but so this opacity mask here is now this gradient mesh. So I can make this and really make that a dramatic transparency that works like this. So how that gradient mesh looks is just like this. So when I alt click into my mask, I can see that again, and then you go back. So that's another way of creating some nice and soft transparency. Sorry for that confusion.
I was thinking if using this three-dimensional revolve or tool to create a cylinder is the best way, not to do as we made in the first class with a rectangle.
I would not use the revolve for a cylinder. For a cylinder, you have the better version is actually to use the extrude, I think it's called, isn't it? Yes, extrude and bevel. So what it does with the extrude is that it pulls out. So it pulls behind it. And then you can make the cylinder up something like this. And you can then decide on how deep this should be. So you can make the length of this. And then you can decide on if you want to have a diffuse shading or if you don't want to have any shading on this. Okay, so you see the reason why this didn't look good was that because it had a black line around it. Then it extrudes the line as well. So going back to this extrude and bevel, so now you see it has the blue color. So then you can extrude this into a cylinder. This has some pros and cons. What you see here is that you can, if you want to look, have something that have shading and things, it's absolutely the best way. But it makes a much more complex object than the way we did the first day. So if you want a cylinder that you can play with a lot, it may be the better way to just make it out of those primitives. But this is absolutely a possibility, and you can have, if you have no shading, you now have created an object that's totally flat in blue, but when I expand the appearance of this, I can now play with this as objects. So as long as you don't play with shading, it can be a very simple object also when you extrude it like this. And then you can yourself decide on the the color of the surface like this. So that's clearly a possibility for doing cylinders as well, or cubes, or anything like that. But just a tip that working without shading will always mean that you have much more simple objects than having highlights and these kind of things. It will end up with many objects in there.
If you have a plasma and you have a rectangular that is supposed to How do you align a rectangle into a circle? Bend and follow the shape of the circle.
I would actually do a pattern brush for that, and then you can just actually put it in as part of a circle. So it's not that difficult in the way that you would just create one end. Well, I would just probably use again this divide below. So you just make this object here into three. So you need to have a start, a finish, and a mid. And maybe it doesn't have to be this wide. I'll just go in like this. And you use this option, divide below. So you just create three split versions like this. And you can say they should be, let's just make it like that. And say path, no, you don't want to divide below, actually. Okay, I take that back. Because you don't want to have the filled edges there. You want to use the scissor tool. Where is now the scissor? I always forget that. It's here, isn't it? Yes. So in the scissor tool, you can cut this object up into the middle place and these ends. And then, so what you just do then is to have your start object, your finish object and your center. And you create a brush of the center object here, make a new brush, a pattern brush. And once I've done that, I can pull in the start, which is supposed to be this one, and the end supposed to be here. Now you have created a very simple box that if I take, let's see, my circle, it should be quite big. And let me just divide that up also to make it look. So I just take one radius of a circle and add this one to it. It wasn't perfectly done, but you see that sort of principle works. And if I would have spent some more time, the reason why this came out like this, if you want to know, is that because these cuts are not parallel. So it tries to fit the outermost edges and then it makes the spacing. But if I would have spent more time on that, you would have this filling that. And then you can, of course, create this much more in an advanced version. You could combine this. I can see this working quite nicely if you combined it with a sphere or a cylinder like this. You can get that cylinder shape out of your genes to have a cylinder end in one going around, cylinder end in the other.
If you convert character to outline, can you reconvert it?
No, you can't. Once it's there, it's lost, unfortunately. Then you have to go to these sort of OCR, this optical character recognition, to bring it back. But it's not very exact. So I would avoid that.
What about if you get like these boxes with a cross within it that you cannot recognize the character? Can you still find the character?
Yes, so that's where, if you see that from a PDF, that's where placing it. If you remember this placing command of a PDF, let me just see if I can just take any recent PDF to show this. Let me just get one from this year. It's of course a very nice one. And then, so if I take this PDF here and I try to open in Illustrator. So if I choose to just open this in Illustrator, it should complain that I'm missing a lot of fonts. And then when I'm opening this, unfortunately, this looks actually quite reasonable. But often you would have missing shapes. Nothing is missing in this one. Okay, bad example. But let me just try one more paper. Should have hoped to have. Normally, the nature ones are tricky.
I have problems with GraphPad.
Yeah, so GraphPad can be also one example of that. Let me see if this one works just for that example. Ah, it's opening the same one, sorry. This one is supposed to be. So just to show you how to do that, this is complaining for a lot of text. Yeah, so this is a typical example. So you're trying to bring this in, and it doesn't have the right font, so it makes a mess out of the text here, because it's trying to replace it with another font. So what you do then is instead is to use this place command and use the link to the file. And when it places that same side, you see it now looks perfect. It has the same what it should look with the text. It should have. I wonder. Yeah. So you have a GraphPad, you have exported this as a PDF.
Right.
And then you place the PDF.
Yeah.
Strange. Okay, that worked. Okay, that's good. Otherwise, I don't know if I can give you the right. Let me just double check that in Windows and see if that would actually work. But it's supposed to be the same thing there. Just maybe we can squeeze in one more question in between, and I'll check that. Any questions?
So, there was the
opacity problem in CS5,
but I
yes. No, I can't check it on my computer, but we had a computer with CS5 back there, so we can check that afterwards. Definitely. Let me just check if this same thing is true in. So now we're in Windows, and we just make a new object. So the important thing is that you start with a new document, that you don't go open, because if you open instead of place, then you will not have the link option. But so at least the link option is down here. But I wonder if, so you mean that when you select your file,
let me just.
Yeah, exactly. If you open, then you ruin that whole thing. So you need to place. That's the key thing. So you place, and then you go to this flattened transparency with full vectors and convert text to outlines. And when you do that, then you get this whole object in where you can select everything like that. Okay. Yeah, so that clarifies things then. Very good. So maybe we are happy for today. I hope you felt that this was also a useful session and that you can have use of some of the tools at least. One thing, these sessions will also come out on the net, so I'll let you know when they are out. Maybe I'll shorten down the first discussion a bit in the morning. That may not be as useful as the other ones. If there are any tools that I brought up there, I'll cut them into the afternoon sessions. But otherwise, thank you all very much for coming. And I would urge you, I'll send out a new link for evaluation. And it would be very valuable if you can fill it in. I know it's a little bit many questions, but just sort of try to skim through them quickly, because it really helps me to decide on if we want to make this course further on to streamline it and fit better people's needs. Great. Thank you.